The purpose of this video is to give us a sense of how is it that the model we create tells us something about reality? How is it connected to reality? And so what we want to do is let's look at this as an example. And let's say that we wanted to use a data set to test the causal hypothesis that someone's average lifetime income had a causal effect on their age at death. So this causal effect is a little bit different than the one we saw in the video called What is a Cause? That cause was smoking, which we could say was either yes or no for each individual. Here we have a continuous measure as a cause. So how do we think about that in terms of a causal framework? Well, before we said with smoking that you would just imagine the population as if everyone was a smoker and then think about the risk of lung cancer, and then think about the population if everyone was a non-smoker and then think about the risk of lung cancer. And if you thought that the risk of lung cancer would be different in those two conditions, then you can go ahead and hypothesize that smoking is a cause of lung cancer. But here we don't have a yes or no variable. Average income is a continuous variable. So sometimes when trying to decide if you think that a continuous variable could be a cause of a particular outcome, it's helpful just to, in your mind for a moment, to think of it like a binary variable. So for average lifetime income, we might think of it as high income versus low income. And then we think about the population, everyone in the population under a condition of high income, and think about what their average age at death would be, and then think of everyone in the population at a low average income and think about what their age at death would be. And if we think that the age at death would be different, then we can go ahead and hypothesize that average lifetime income is a cause of differences in the age at death in the population. So the way it comes out in our model will be different than that, but that'll at least help us to decide whether or not we think that we can hypothesize a particular causal effect. So if we were to do this, and let's say that these people here on the left-hand side, these represent the people who are in our data set. Now, if we want to test this causal relationship between average lifetime income and age at death, then one of the things we're going to have to do is that we're going to have to measure both of these variables on every single person in our data set. So we would have every person's lifetime average income, and we would have their age at death. And once we have that, then we could set up our data to look like this. So for each person, we'd have, you know, one row of data, and we would, this is person one, and their average income is $10,000 per year, and their age at death was 57, and so on for each person. So what we're doing in these kinds of models that we're building, we can think of it as looking for patterns in the data. And to see what that means, let's draw a picture over here, and let's put the average income on the left-hand side, and we're just going to use a bar to represent the income. This person's income is $10,000 per year, so we put the bar at $10,000, and their age at death is 57. This right-hand column is the age at death. And so we begin to just go through the people in our data set, and when we show the data visually like this, we begin to see a very clear pattern. So as the lifetime average income per year increases, the age at death tends to increase. And so this is just a pattern in the data that we can see. And the connection between what we see in our data, these patterns, and reality is down here in this lower right-hand corner. So if we see this kind of pattern where one variable tends to move with another variable, then we can hypothesize three basic causal structures that relate these two variables together. Now, one of them is our hypothesis that the person's average income has a causal effect on their age at death. That's one possibility. Now, another possibility, though, is what we would call reverse causation, that the age at death actually has a causal effect on their average lifetime income. This is called reverse causality, but here it doesn't make much sense, right? Because how could someone's age at death, you know, retroactively have an effect on their income earlier in their life? So sometimes we can discount certain causal hypotheses that would explain our data just because they they don't make sense, right? But this is, technically, this is a possible causal relationship that could cause the kind of pattern that we see up here. Now, there is a third one, which is that there may be some other variable which is a cause of both income and age at death. Now, in this example, it might be something like, you know, social discrimination against particular people in the population. And so that discrimination actually keeps them from having a fair access to the job market. So they tend to have lower incomes. And that discrimination also has an effect, adverse effect on their health, which causes them to die at a lower age. And so this kind of relationship is called, this is a classic representation of confounding. We would say that this social discrimination is confounding the association between income and age at death. Now, it's possible that there's an arrow here as well from income to age at death, and there's also confounding. So these, we're going to be building these graphs, and they can get more complex. We'll be seeing that later. But the point here is that these are the three basic structures that can account for an association between two variables, okay? And so we need to be thinking through all of these different possibilities when we're trying to connect the patterns that we see in the data, the associations that we see in the data, to a reality. So let's look at this in a little bit different way. So now what I want to do is in addition to putting the data in two columns, I'm going to put the income information vertically and the age at death information horizontally. And so I'm just going to represent the data in this way. And so you see this is just the same information in a different kind of way. And now what we're going to do is we're going to represent the position of these two bars by drawing a line up from each bar and putting a dot in the spot where the two lines intersect. And so if we do this for all of our data, we can build up lines or dots for these data. Now this is basically just another way to represent the data, right? So this is exactly the same information that we saw when we were going through each person one by one, and we were looking at the patterns, but now we can see all of the information on one graph, okay? And so what we're going to be doing is we're going to be using this kind of representation of the information when we're building models. And, you know, this is probably you've seen this before. This is just a representation of a regression model with these two variables. And so this model here is essentially just a way to represent the patterns that we see in the data, right? And if we see this kind of representation of the patterns of the data, then we can hypothesize these different causal structures that are accounting for the association that we see in the data. So there are three basic patterns that we see when we represent the information in this particular way. One is that the line is going up to the right. And when that happens, if we just sort of look through the what's happening, is that the variables are moving together. When one goes up, the other one goes up. Another way we can see is that when the line is going down to the right. And here we can see that what's happening is that the variables are, when one goes up, the other goes down. So in either of these situations, when the variables are moving together or when the variables are moving against each other, we can hypothesize these different causal relationships that is explaining why we see that kind of pattern in the data. Now over here, when the line is flat, that means that there's no association between the variables. And what we'll see down here is that they tend to move together kind of haphazardly. So if we look at this, you can see that they're moving, but they're not really moving together with any kind of clear pattern. And when we see this kind of thing, then we basically assume that there is none of these conditions is true. So there's no causal connection between these two variables. Okay. So the final thing to remember here is that when we represent the data in this particular form, when we see a kind of slope in this model going up to the right or going down to the right, then this means that there's an association between the two variables. And then we can begin to hypothesize that there are these one of these kind of causal relationships between the variables. And when this is flat, then we see no association, and we hypothesize that there is no causal connection between them. So this is the way that our model is connected to reality. And so this is the framework that we're going to be using to interpret our model to say something about the causal structure of reality.